So the hypertext transfer protocol, HTTP, we will go through concepts, a sample web page, and then what the cookies do, what the proxy servers do, and so on and so forth. So the way HTTP works is that there is a server and there are lots of clients. And so when you type something in your browser, the browser is the client. It sends a request to the server, and the server sends a response. Okay? Another client might also send another request, and they get response. So a lot of clients are getting served at the same time. And your browser, for example, whether you have Internet Explorer, Microsoft, Edge, Firefox, name it, your Safari, whatever, those are all the clients. And they all do something very similar, which is written in the standard. So the server could be a Microsoft Information Internet Information Service, IIS, or Apache. Okay, so one of those two, and they do something which is standard again. So we'll talk about that. So the web page that you see in front of you, like this could be a web page itself, it consists of many objects. It consists of this text. It consists of this picture. It consists of that picture. It consists of that picture and other things. Right? All of those could be coming in pieces. You don't just get one big picture on your screen from the server. Server sends pieces, and your browser knows how to present those pieces on your screen, because your screen could be so small, so big, this side, that side. And so the server sends the same information, actually generally the same information. It could be different information depending upon the client. But the client, which is your browser, arranges it on your screen. Okay? All right. So once that is understood, so the web page is a group of objects, and the objects could be text, images, files, and URL. URL is the uniform resource locator, like this one, http://. This whole thing is a URL. This is the locator. This is what we are trying to find. That's why we call it locator. Right? So this we type it in, right? And generally nowadays, the browsers type it, most of it for you. You just start with something and they figure out what is the rest. But when the server gets it, they get the whole thing. So HTTP uses TCP. So we said there are two transport protocols, TCP and what? UDP. So it doesn't use TCP. But the second big thing is that it is stateless. So what does stateless mean? And we will be using the word state quite often in this course. And state simply means memory. Can you remember something? If you remember something, that is, you have a state. If you don't remember anything, then you are stateless. And so the server is stateless. So you say, you go to the server, let's say Amazon, and you say, okay, show me a Dell computer. So they will show you a Dell computer page. Now it doesn't remember that it showed you a Dell computer page. Can you believe that? That is the case. Is that it doesn't remember what it showed it to you. The server moves on to the next client. The next client says, show me a Microsoft computer in our web windows or whatever. It shows it to them and then moves on. So it doesn't keep memory. All right? So server is stateless, non-persistent. And persistent and non-persistent are the two things for the TCP connection. If you make a TCP connection and keep it alive for a long time, then it is persistent. On the other hand, you make a connection, turn it down, make a connection, turn it down, make a connection, turn it down, disconnect. That is non-persistent. And both are allowed. In the beginning, when the HTTP came about, it was non-persistent. So if you needed five objects on a page, you made five connections. You made the first connection, got the first object, got the second connection, second object, third object. That was just too much waste of time. All right? So persistent and non-persistent. server leaves the connection open for sending an object and closes it on timeout. And so what now they do is that they let you ask and ask and ask, and when you don't ask after some time, they will timeout. Now, why that is a problem? You see, the problem is that the servers are serving millions of clients, and if they have to keep memory for each one of them, even if they keep, let's say, 1 kilobyte for each client, they will need several megabytes to remember all that. Okay? So they just don't like to keep servers. Servers don't like to keep state. They don't like to keep persistence. They don't like to do and forget. Okay? Now, web pages are written in a language called Hypertext Markup Language, HTML. So differentiate between HTTP and HTML. HTML is the language to write the page. HTTP is the protocol to get the page. All right. How many of you have written HTML? Half of the class. The other half who has not written an HTML, it is very simple and you should write it today. Okay. It's very easy to learn. And in every course that I generally teach, the senior level course, not this one, the more higher up level, we used to ask the students to write a paper, and the papers are all written in HTML. And HTML looks like this. It's very easy. Every HTML page starts with the word HTML. Okay? In an angle bracket, open and close. HTML. Then there is a head, open and close. Then there is a body, open and close. Inside the body, there is some information, and then there is a HTML close. So everything that opens closes. And basically, in the head, there is information, which is the header of this page. And in the body, there is something that you can see. So this body consists of just three lines. First line says image source jain.jpg. So it says that first thing they need is an image, and the source file is jain.jpg. So the server looks for that file in its directory. If it finds it, it sends it to this client. And the second thing is the text. BR means break, line break. And Raj Jain is the name. So if you write this page and then somebody requests it, this is what they will get. Very nice. They will see my picture and they will see my name. Right? And you can do the same thing with your pictures. So the thing is, now there are many ways to move things around, create spaces, you know, things like that, and click and all that. And it's very simple to read and write. Okay, it's not a magic. It's very simple, much simpler than anything else you have learned. So I'm not going to teach you how to write HTML, but I just want you to be familiar with it. And that's not really required for this course. But the more you know, better it is. HTML, I don't think you can get much ahead in computer science without knowing HTML. So just learn it. So now, once a page exists, then how do you get it? So this is HTTP. So now I'm going to move on to HTTP. HTTP is part of this course. We need to know the protocol, right? So the protocol is that an interesting thing about HTTP is that this is one of the first protocol that was written in ASCII. ASCII is the American, you know, this interchange, whatever, I forgot the name. But anyway, information interchange. And so basically you can read it. So this is a message. This is how it is sent to the computer in ASCII. You can read it on the wire. On the wire, there's a letter G, there's a letter E, there's a letter T. Most of the other protocols will be in binary. You cannot read them. They will be 10, 10, 10 kind of thing. Here it is ASCII. Okay. And so the message will start like this. It will say get. And then this is the URL from this host, and the connection close means open the TCP connection, send me this and close it right away. And I am Mozilla 4.0. So if you're using Firefox, it's a Mozilla. That is the original source. Okay. And Internet Explorer will say something else. So this is that, and accept language EN. And I only need in English, not in Chinese or any other language. If you were doing in Chinese, then you will say CN or whatever, right? So it will give you the answer in that language. Okay? So there are four parts. First, you have to have the method. What is it that you want to do? In this case, you want to get. Sometimes you don't want to get, you want to put. And it will come in a minute. But get is the most common thing that you want to get something from the server. URL. You all know that you have to specify something, but we specify in two parts. Host is here and the rest of it is here. Okay? You would have put, to get this thing, you would have put http://www.cse.bushtel.edu/ all that. Okay? But the browser will break into two parts, the host part and this part. And by the way, you should know that host names are case insensitive. That means you can write them in uppercase or lowercase, it doesn't matter. Okay? The directory, this directory and these things are not case sensitive. They are case sensitive, they're not case insensitive. So if you write uppercase Jain or uppercase CSE or uppercase sample, it will miss. It will say not found. Okay? So you know which part is case sensitive? This part is case sensitive. And what is not case sensitive? The host name. Okay? All right. And the version. So you have to say what language we speak. So this browser is speaking HTTP version 1.1. There are many versions of HTTP, the protocol. There are many versions of HTML. Right now we are in HTML 5, right? But don't confuse HTML with HTTP. In HTTP, we are at 1.1 or so. So HTTP 1.1 is what is being spoken. And then these are the other fields. Host is one field, connection is another field, user agent another field. Each field is followed by a colon, and then the answer to that question. Okay, so now can you read HTTP messages? All right, so you know basically how to read them. And you should be, and I will show you in a minute, you should be able to actually hear the thing though. If you're talking to a server, you don't need a browser. You can just type this thing and they will answer. So people can just write, you can write GET and this and that to the server, and the server will answer you. All right, so the message format. Generally, the protocol we specify is like this. And so this protocol consists of many lines. And each line ends with a CRLF. What is CRLF? Have you heard that before? Carriage return and line feed. This is one protocol that is in ASCII and that really knows the line and all that. Other protocols which are in binary, which we'll see like FTP, they don't have any of this. So each line ends with a CRLF. The first line should have the method space, URL space, version, and that's it. Second line should have a header field, a colon, the value and the CRLF. Header field, colon, value and CRLF, and so on and so forth. At the end, you will have two CRLFs. Okay, that means a blank line. And then you will have some stuff that is the body. So right now in the request, there was no body, but when the response comes back, there will be a big body. Okay? So here is the response. Response is http://1.1200OK. Connection close, date, server, last modified, length, content length 6500, content type text HTML, and then there's a big data here. Okay, so let's read it line by line. The first line says that I speak HTTP 1.1. You speak HTTP 1.1, but I may speak only one. Who knows? All right? But in this case, both of them speak 1.1, which is good. All right? So server speaks 1.1 and 200, okay. So really what a server wants to say is, okay, what you said, I understood everything and everything is fine. But just to make it easy for the machines, it gives the answer in two ways. It gives in English and it gives it in numeric. 200 is the code means that everything is okay. All right. There are other codes. For example, if you would have said 301, that means the object doesn't exist here anymore. If it had 400, means you didn't speak it right. 404 means not found. 505 is that you speak something that I don't understand. Okay. So these codes are the things which are standardized, and all the browsers and all the servers understand those codes. But just for human beings, same thing might be repeated in English. Okay. All right. So that is the first line. Second line is straightforward. Connection closed. Because you asked me to close, I closed it. This is the current time. This is the current, and this is who am I. I am running this kind of server. And this object that I'm sending you was last modified on this date. Its length is 6500 and it is a text. Okay, there are many different kinds of objects. Images is one of them, but text is another one of them. Okay. And so this is a response. Any question about the response? All right, so again, you have to put down in a format, like just like we did before. The responses consist of version, followed by a space, followed by the code, followed by a space, followed by a phrase, followed by CRLF. Then header field colon space value CRLF. Header field colon space CRLF, CRLF, another CRLF, and then the body. All right. So now what you can do is you can talk to a server by yourself. You don't need a browser. So we will do this without a browser. Open a command prompt on your computer. Not right now, but at your home. And telnet to the server. Now somebody had asked what is a telnet. Telnet is one of the oldest protocols to talk to any computer. Okay. And so you can say telnet to www.1.cse.worcester.edu colon AD. Or maybe space AD. I'm not sure about that. Maybe space AD will do. But basically what I'm saying is that I want to talk to you on port 80. Every computer has many different ports. 80 is what is used for HTTP, standard port, right? So telnet is not HTTP. If you were doing HTTP, it will be understood that you want to speak on port 80, but telnet is general, right? Telnet is just to speak. I want to speak to you, but it says on port 80. Then you type exactly what they would have gotten. We say GET space, all that, host that, and so on and so forth. And then you just put two character returns. Now, since you put two lines, you didn't specify the other things, and that's okay. The server understood this much, and it will come back on your screen. It will say HTTP, okay, blah, 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 and this is the thing, and then it will say, this is the page. The page will come back to you exactly, you know, as it was written by the person. It will say HTML, head, body, whatever. You get that. Now it is up to you to present that. In your case, you're not going to present it, but if it was a browser which gets it, they will present it. This is a sample text. Okay. So HTML will come back to you, but the HTML to screen is done by the browser. In this case, you will just see raw HTML. Any questions so far? So now continue. Now you say, okay, I want to go to 473-08. So only thing I have changed here is instead of 16 or 18, I put the year 08. And since that page doesn't exist, the answer will come out 404 not found. Okay? So it says that I didn't find the page. And then the body would be all this long. Which you can, if there is a browser, it will put exactly this thing. Not found, the requested URL was not found on the server, and this is the server port 80, whatever. So all this thing came from the server. All right. Now, once the HTTP was designed, okay, it was designed in France, as you know, and people started using it, and the businesses wanted to use it, they found a big problem with it. The big problem is the Amazon just showed you a page, let's say on Dell computer, and now you say, I want to buy it. The computer doesn't remember, the server doesn't remember what it showed it to you, right? So that's the problem. So they said, no, this memory-less stuff is not good. I want to have some state. I want the server to remember what it has showed to the client. And the way to remember that is that the server will keep the information that it wants to remember at a place somewhere in its disk or someplace and give it to you a number which to the client. So when the client comes back next time, he says, look, I am that client, 4335, you had told me, right? So then it will go back to 4335 and figure out, oh, you were looking at Dell computer, so you want to buy Dell computer. Right? And that is what we call cookie. So your browser will store that information, that number 4335, forever in your computer. If 1 month later you come back to Amazon, when it sends a request, it will say, well, last time you had told me 4335, so here it is. So then it will say, last time you were looking at 4335 at Dell computer. So it will show you all the ads about Dell computer and so on and so forth. So many people don't like that idea that, you know, why do they have to know what I was looking at? And so they want to kill the cookies. But if you kill the cookies, you can't really do any business on the internet. Okay? So the cookies are the one that make it work. In spite of everything that you have read about negative about cookies, you know, if you're going to a bad website and you don't want that anybody to know, then of course you kill the cookies. But if you're going to Amazon, you better have cookies. Right? So this is how it works. The client says, let's see, eBay 8734. So this is a question about eBay. Okay, this is it. I'm talking to eBay and I send them 8734, which could be on eBay my client number. So maybe eBay remembers everything that I ever bought from them, but they will keep it in a location 8734. Okay, so they right away know that I'm Rob Jain and this is my buying history and this is what I love, this is what I don't like. And so page that will be presented to me will be related to that number. So actually, somehow, these things are kind of out of sync here. eBay to Amazon server, I don't know. I think we should have Amazon 8734. But anyway, so basically, when you send this, the Amazon server creates the entry and gives you 1678. Okay? And then when you go to Amazon, every time you just give that. So you give the cookie 1678 and you get the response. Later on when you go, you give 1678 and you get the response. So now everybody knows where they are, what they were doing before. So what we have done is we have put a state in the system. State means memory in the system. Both sides remember what they had done before. Okay, so you understand the purpose of cookies? Yeah.
So this is like slightly off topic, but there's this topic called bouncer thing. So because it used to be on the side of the world. So they use email, which is where they go across any
Okay, so all right. So I have simplified this stuff here. The cookie is not just one number. If you really look at the cookie in your browser cache, which you can. They are this big long, 5,000 characters, okay? It has everything, your date of birth, your mother's name, and everything else, okay? I mean, it could have anything that Amazon needs to sell it. Okay. It could have your email address, you name it. So there's no standard format for cookies. As long as the server understands that cookie, that's all there is. So the server sends you some big number, a big string, that is your cookie. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, really, kind of like place cookies.
Well, so I don't know about that system, but basically cookie could be anything. It could be your email address, it could be a number, it could be a combination of many things. Okay? So basically what that does is once they get it, so for example, most websites, when I go there, my bank, if I don't have the cookie, they will ask me to have three-factor verification, two-factor verification, where is your phone number, this and that. But if there's a cookie, it's very easy. They know that this guy had been here before. Yeah. Okay, so the question is, how is cookie better than login password? So cookie doesn't replace them. They both exist at the same time. So for example, when I go to my bank, I have to log in every single time. What cookie does is, it just makes it another thing that they know that this cookie I had given to Rajan, and this is a very complicated cookie. The cookie that you get from the bank is actually encrypted and coded so that only they know how to read it, right? When they get that particular string and it makes sense to them, they know that this is Rajan. They will still ask me for the name and password. All right, but what they will not ask me is to do a two-factor authentication. I'm going to send you a code to your phone. They will not do that. But if I don't give them the cookie, they will say, okay, now be ready. I'm sending you a code. Give me the code. Once I get the code, then they send me the cookie. And then I'm ready for the next time. Does that answer the question? Okay. All right. Are you marking these corrections? Just eBay8734 is not a correct name for a user. I think the user name should be something like my name or your name or something. eBay164 is the username. Okay. So now there's one more optimization. And that optimization has to do with, why do we have to go all the way to the server to get the information? Because if you have a company and with thousands of employees, or you know, like WashU is a company with 50,000 students or 5,000 students, all of them are going to go and read the same thing, maybe the news about our country. Then why do we have to go to the original news source? We could just keep a copy here, right? And that is done, and that is called proxy server. So basically what proxy server does is, when somebody is trying to reach, let's say, USA Today, or Wall Street Journal, or Washington Post, the server will read your request and say, hey, you don't want to go to Wall Street. Somebody else had just read that same item before. It has it in its disk and it will give it to you right from there. So what the company has done is saved a lot of traffic going to the internet, which can be used for something better. Right? So what the proxy server does is, it acts like an actual server. Okay, not just for one server, for many, many servers. So it could proxy anything that is going out, and if it has it, it will give it to you. Sometimes it has part of it. So you need five things, and it has three of them. It will ask for two from the original source and give you five. That is how proxy server works. So the proxy server caches the object. Only new objects are requested from the original server, and that way it is very fast. The response is fast, and the less traffic on the link. Okay. So proxy server can also, to make proxy server work, they added conditional get. Conditional get says that please send me this particular thing. For example, please send me Raj Jain's picture if it has changed since last January. And then the picture is so big, 5 megabytes. So the picture will be sent only if it has changed. If it has not changed, it will say, sorry, it did not change. You use the old picture. Right? If it has changed, then it will be sent. So it will get the response 304 not modified, or okay, and here is the data. Do you understand the conditional get? Conditional get is that because this proxy server doesn't know what has been modified, what has changed, what has not changed, it will probably send conditional get for many of the things. Now, what happens is actually in many of these responses, it not only has the last modified, like here, there was somewhere we saw last modified, right here. Last modified, it will also put lifetime. It will also say that this is good only for next 10 days. Or it is only good for next 10 seconds. Okay? Many things change very fast, like your bank account balance. Okay? I mean, they would not let you use the same bank account balance which you start today and withdraw tomorrow, right? So they will say, okay, this is good only for 1 second. And then if you want to check the balance again, you have to go to the original source again and then check the balance again. If you want to show it again, you want to go back. So everything has a lifetime. Some of the things that don't change, like newspaper headlines, they don't change. They say, okay, I like this, it's good for 10 minutes. Okay? If you want to read the headlines again, 10 minutes later you come back, you get a new headline. You understand? So we have conditional get. And that brings us to the end of HTTP. 6 key things to remember. First of all, HTTP is a client-server protocol, and it uses text-based messages. So this is one of the first protocols which use text-based messages. Okay, because before that, and we designed plenty of those protocols, they were all binary. Why they were binary? Because in the old days, we didn't have too many, networks were so slow. Remember I told you that the first network that I used was 110 bits per second. 110 bits per second. Right? Today, you multiply that by a million and I have that at my home. 110 million bits per second. So 110 bits per second was the network. So every bit that we sent on the network was very expensive. And so we didn't want to say GET, that is 8-bit, lots of 24 bits, when I could say 0-1. Right? So the all original protocols were binary. But by 1994, when this was done, HTTP, the networks had become faster and the bits were not an issue. And the person inventing it was not a computer scientist, actually, was a physicist. And he just, you know, made it the simplest way. And it clicked. Basically, people like it. Because now anybody can debug the messages, anybody can look at the messages, change it, so on and so forth. So it is basically forever. Okay? So many of the new protocols that we are designing, they are ASCII, they are text-based. Second thing is, they are written in HTML. Okay? And then they use persistent or non-persistent connection. The cookies allow the server to maintain the state. The protocol is actually stateless, but the cookies allow to maintain the state. And proxy servers improve the performance by caching, and the conditional get allows proxy servers to work, you know, because they can just get the information that has changed. Any question about any of these? None? So then you have a homework. HTTP 2A, HTTP homework 2A. So this thing is given, and you just have to answer what is the server, was it successful, what time the reply was printed, what is the document modified, etc., etc. So you should be just able to read HTTP. Louder, please. What are the first byte of the document being returned? Okay, so the thing is, the document is being returned is this. So the first 5 bytes are these. No, this ASCII character is fine. I mean, the question was, by the way, because each ASCII character has a binary equivalent. So how do you write a C, right? For example, I remember A is 64, capital A is 64, 65 maybe. And so should I write that binary? No. Any other question? All right. Now there is a lab along with it, which is related to domains. It's very simple. These things are, you know, kind of simple. I'm just trying to bring you up. And so the first thing you already did before, I think, IP address of Google by using Flink. This is a repeat. Modify the host file to map Google to Yahoo app address. Now, how many of you know what is a host file? So, actually, this is slightly ahead of, we are going to talk about this later on, maybe more. But here's the idea, that when you have a name like google.com, it has to be converted into an address. And that is done by just looking up the name in some place. And the first place they look at is in your own computer. In your computer, there is a file called host, H-O-S-T, no extension. Okay, maybe it has an S in that, H-O-S-T. Anyway, no extension. In that, there is a list. It says name, address, name, address, name, address, name, address. Okay. So the first thing they look at is that file. Okay, that file could be blank, in which case everything has to be sent somewhere outside to find out. Right? Whatever is not in the file, we send it to some name server and
they have the similar file. So now somebody can come and change your host file, or you can change your own host file,
and right there, so that google.com becomes yahoo.com. All right?
And you will have fun. Every time you want to go to Google, Yahoo page will show up. All right? So find the domain name. So this is one thing, right? Second thing is, find the domain name and country. So every address was assigned by somebody. And so we know who it is assigned to. For example, 128.252, this is assigned to Bristol, so that we know. So basically, you have to find out what is the domain name and country of this address. And the way you can figure this out is by going to this URL. So just go to your browser and then put this address after you get to this website. It will tell you that this is St. Louis, Missouri, Washington University. Or, you know, if you put another address, it will tell you this is Germany, this is China, this is whatever. So, you know where the countries, the companies, or the addresses are located. Find the owner of the w.edu domain. And then sometimes, some people are doing mischief. In my case, so for example, that making copies of my book available on the internet, I have to write to them and say, look, this is illegal. So, you need to know the domain name administrator, right? They are all listed someplace. So you can find out who is the owner of the bushtel.edu domain, and you can do that here. Okay? And then find the name server of the bushtel.edu domain, and then you have to find out where the names are kept in our domain. You can find that out here. So the idea is all this information is there, and sometimes you need them. So this particular thing is just going to the website and finding them out. Everything is due next Monday. So it's only half of the class. It's today only Monday. So Wednesday also, whatever we do, will be due on Monday. Now, what we do make sure is that these are very small assignments. Actually, they don't take time. The numbers may be large, maybe 3 or 4 or 5 or 6, but each of them take 5-10 minutes. Okay, so it's not big assignment. So yeah, so basically, and it just extends the knowledge that you have. All right, so lab 2A is done. Any question about this? All right, then we move on to electronic mail. How does the mail work? Okay, and the mail works very similar way. There is a client-server protocol. There is a server called mail server, and your computer is a client, and they speak a protocol called SMTP. Okay. Now, it is interesting is that the SMTP is not a protocol just spoken between the client and the server. The servers also speak SMTP. Okay. So this is server, this is server, this is server. All the servers are speaking SMTP. Okay. And the user agent is your client, which is like Outlook, or sometimes it is your web server, your browser, whatever is the user agent. And so they send a request, SMTP. SMTP is Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. And it allows only 7-bit ASCII messages. all binary objects have to be converted to ASCII and uses port 25 at the server. So let me explain line by line. First of all, it uses 7-bit ASCII messages. So a byte has 8 bits. ASCII uses only 7 bits of those. The first bit is not used. And so with 7-bit ASCII, you can get 2 raised to 7 is 128 characters. Okay, so some of the special characters, for example, Chinese or German or something, you cannot do them in ASCII. Okay, it is just 128 characters. So that's one problem. And if you have binary, if you're sending a file, which has 00, 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever it is, it has 8 bits, you have to do something to make it 7-bit. Okay, so that's another, that has to, everything has to be ASCII. And it uses port 25 at the server. And the default port is 25. So when you want to talk to the server, you use port 25. So here is how you talk to the server. You can say telnet mail.cs.gustl.edu. This is my mail server. I'm sure this is also your mail server. If not, just put something that is your mail server, which you know from Outlook. And the port 25. Right now, most servers will not talk at port 25. This is an old example. Nowadays, they talk at 565 or something, which is encrypted and so on and so forth. So you have to really find a simple server. Hopefully, this will speak. But anyway, 25. The server will answer you. When you type this, you will get the answer 220 post office.cs.gustl.edu Microsoft ASMTP mail service version ready and so on so forth. Okay, then you can say hello acm.org. Now, here's an interesting thing. This should have been H-E-L-L-O. Hello, right? But the person who wrote the protocol decided to shorten it and wrote H-E-L-O. So that is the actual command, H-E-L-O, hello. That I want to talk to acm.org. So this says the post office says, so this is first of all, this message is going to mail from jane at acm.org. So then you type from field, server says okay. Then you say sending to, it is going to jane at gustl.edu, server says okay. And then you say data, and you send the data, and then it says done, and then you say quit. So you can see how you are talking to the server and you are constructing the mail. Now your Outlook does all this for you, or whatever mail system you are using, they do it for you. But if you were to look on the wire, this is what you will find. Okay. And so now, HTTP and SMTP are very similar. The main differences are that HTTP allows you persistent or non-persistent connection. So in HTTP, you could say connection close or connection open, right? In this case, it is persistent. So all this will continue until you say quit. Right? This is all one TCP connection. And by the way, there's another interesting thing which I didn't mention, that when you send a mail, then the last thing is a dot, single dot on a line. That says my message is over, end of message. Interesting, right? Instead of saying anything else, they decided, or the person who wrote this thing, decided that the dot on a line will mean message is done. Okay, all right. So then second thing is mostly pull and mostly push. Okay, so what does that mean? HTTP doesn't talk to you until you go and say, I want to talk to you. Server doesn't talk to you. Right, so mostly pull. You pull the information. And SMTP, it is mostly push. That mostly you send the information to them, or they send push the information to you. Either you are sending the messages or you are getting the messages. Even if you are not sending, you are getting the messages. So it is push. and accept binary objects, HTTP accept binary objects, and SMTP accept only 7 bit ASCII. Now that is because the time. If they would have designed SMTP today, they would have known that most of the things in the world are binary. But it was designed in the days when internet was just coming up. There were 4 computers on the net, and they were just saying to each other, hello, you know, how are you doing? How are you morning? That's it. Nothing more, right? So the text ASCII was good enough. They were not sending files in those days. Or file, there was somebody else in charge who was writing FTP, right? So they were not being sent by mail. Mail was very simple, and particularly it was simple because it was 110 bit per second network. What can you send on 110 bit per second network? You cannot send a file. It would take hours. So this was only ASCII. And one object per response, if you don't have persistence, and this will send you multiple objects per message. So you keep line, many lines you will get in each message. So there are many mail protocols. SMTP is one of them. Now, SMTP can be used to send messages to destination user agents, request destination to be always accessible. Now, the problem with SMTP is, it is an old protocol. At the time when it was written, the servers used to be available all the time. So, request destination to be available, right? So, soon they realized that this is not possible. That if I'm sending an email to, let's say, my department chair, the chair is there on the chair computer, he's not there, right? So they said, no, you cannot do that. You really have to send it somewhere where it can be stored. When the chair comes back, they can do it, right? So then they had to put another thing. They had to put a server which will save your messages. And when the chair comes back, it will say, okay, I want to get my mail. So they have to design an access protocol. And there are three access protocol. POP3 is one of them. IMAP is second of them. HTTP is third of them. So POP3 is Post Office Protocol version 3. And its job is to go to the server and say, has somebody sent me an email? Please give me all my emails. Right? When somebody sends you the email, they don't come to you, they go to the server. Okay, and they are stored there. So POP3 is the protocol to get the email. And IMAP is another one. Okay, and HTTP is the third one. HTTP we already talked about, so let's talk about POP3. POP3 is like this. The server will say, okay, POP3 server ready. Then you say, hey, I'm Bob. Say, okay. And my password is hungry. Says okay, and then it says, client says list, means please tell me what is there in your cache. And it says, well, I have message number 1, which is 498 characters, message number 2, which is 912 characters, and then dot. That's the end. Okay, and then you say, okay, all right, retrieve 1. You say, I want to get message number 1. So then it says message number 1, it sends you that 498 characters and then says dot. The dot is the end. Okay. Then it says delete 1, retrieve 2. And then you retrieve the 2 and then dot and then delete 2 and then quit and you're done. Okay. So the POP works like that. You don't have to delete the messages after you read. You can just leave it there. It will be there. And then when you read it again, it will be there. Any questions about POP? Have you seen the word POP3 before? Those who are shaking their hand, they have never used Outlook. Because if you use Outlook, you have to put your server name. You have to put the 2 servers, their names are very similar. Their names are generally SMTP dot something. And the server name is POP3 dot something. So for example, when I get it from Wustel, now this is from memory, I could be wrong. I think my server names are SMTP dot outlook something something after that. And similarly, pop3.outlook. When I read it from Yahoo, I put smtp.yahoo and pop3.yahoo. And similarly, when I read from Google, I say the same thing. So those are the servers' names also. They don't have the same name. You don't have to name your server SMTP, but people just do it so that the clients can easily remember. If I name my server as Jain3, who will remember it, right? So it's better that I call it SMTP. Okay? But this is the protocol. IMAP is still similar, but IMAP is slightly more sophisticated than POP3. And what it does is it allows a good cloud service to really keep your messages forever on the server. So it is more sophisticated. It allows you to maintain folders. You can say, well, keep 3 folders, move it from this folder to that folder. Generally, I do that on my computer. I keep many folders on my laptop. But with IMAP, the message doesn't come to you, it stays there. And that is the reason I don't like IMAP. So I basically want to keep everything in my computer and not anywhere else. So IMAP I don't use, but basically that is the feature, is that you don't have to keep it. You can read messages from different places like your phone or something, and they're still there. So allows user to maintain folders on the server. Messages can be moved from one folder to another. User can get only the headers or the components of the message. You can just see the header only, and then so on and so forth. So the IMAP is another protocol. Now, we don't have to go to the detail of the protocol. I mean, if you really need, whenever you need it, you can go to that website, find all the details. Question? So that brings us to the end of mail. And the mail is, SMTP is the protocol to send the mail. And SMTP uses 7-bit ASCII messages. And POP3, IMAP, and HTTP are used to receive the mail. So you cannot send the mail using POP3. POP3 is to access, to get. Any questions about any of these three protocols? So with everything that we finished, we have a homework. So with the mail, here's the homework, and let's see if you can do it. It should be easy to do, very simple. That this is the email with POP3, list, retrieve, and so on and so forth. Now you just have to answer the question. What will happen after this, right? Configure, complete the above transaction. So if you have to keep the, to operate in the download and keep mode, which means when somebody has downloaded, the message is not deleted automatically. You can also say auto delete, which means that every time you download, the message is deleted. In this case, the message is still there. Next time when you come back, it will still list it. Suppose you have configured your POP client to operate in the download and keep mode. Using the transaction in part B, this one, suppose you retrieve message 1 and you retrieve message 1 and 2. There are 1 and 2. And exit the POP. And then minutes later you come back. Now suppose in the 5 minutes interval no new messages have been sent to you. Then what will happen? Okay. Now you have set it that download and keep. Right? So the messages have not been deleted. So when you come back, you can see what will happen, right? Any questions about that? Yeah. Whichever you ask first. The thing is, what will happen is when you say list, it will list in the numerical order, 1, 2, 3, 4. And it doesn't have to be all 3, 4. It will be 1, 2, 4, and 5. 3 was deleted, right? Servers first, basically 1 came first and then 2 came. So basically, as the messages come, they are numbered, right? So actually, it may not be 1 or 2. It could be 2345. Okay, 2356. The number keeps going up, right? And then you have deleted the first 2345, so they won't show up. It will say, server will say 2346, 2347, and 2359. You get it? Okay. All right. Moving along. DNS. DNS is domain name service. How do we change, translate the names to the addresses? So what is a hierarchy? How does it work? What is a record, message formats, etc. we will talk about. So DNS. So DNS translates a name to the address. So there was a time, like, you know, maybe up to 1980s, when there was no DNS. So you couldn't write a name. You had to know the address exactly of everybody. So we had to remember those numbers like 128, 252, things like that. And people said, no, this is difficult. Right? So they said, okay, all right, we will give them a name that you can remember, and then we will keep a directory somewhere where we can translate the name to the number. And that is DNS. So DNS translates the host name to IP address. And so there is a distributed database of all hosts in the universe. Now remember, universe is bigger than the earth. All right? So everywhere, wherever in the Mars or wherever there is a computer, there is a name. This is all kept in a database. However, the database is distributed. Distributed means it is not at one place. It is in every place. It's like a god. Okay? It's every place. Basically, it just basically every company, for example, IBM has a database. Booster has a database. I have a database. Everybody has a database. And then when you want to find out, everybody has a copy of it. If you don't have a copy of it, you can go back to the original place and find it out. So I will show you how that is done. But the distributed database, that is one thing to remember. It's not centralized. So then it also allows, DNS also allows you to host alias. Host alias means that you can have multiple names. For example, when you type, and this is really true, if you type on your browser www.rajjain.com, what you will see is this, because I have defined it that way. Okay, I own that domain, and I have defined that whenever somebody wants to go to that domain, they come to my WashU website. You can do the same thing. And in fact, first thing you should do after this is go and buy a domain in your name. You know, I mean, it's good to have your own name and domain. Okay. And so, by the way, you cannot get Rajjain anymore because there are millions of Rajjain, and I bought this 30 years ago, 20 years ago. So the names are going away. All right. So, anyway, so when you buy a domain, then you can set a lot of things. And one of the things you can say is that where mail servers are, where web server is, where name server, everything else you can define about that domain. So I put it like this. So that is called aliasing. Okay? Mail server aliasing. So for example, if you send a mail to jain@bustle.edu, the sender has to know where is the mail kept in bustle.edu. All right? So there is a particular host in bustle.edu that keeps the mail. That record is kept in the DNS. Similarly, and many of these are multiple addresses. So for example, if you ask that question now, there will be one answer. A bit later, there will be different answers. For example, I told you about www.google.com. Just go ahead and ping it. It will give you one address. And 1 hour later, ping it again, it will be a different address. Because Google wants its traffic rotated. They have 10 servers in St. Louis, and they don't want everybody to go to the same server all the time. Right? So you can do that load distribution. And so let's see how DNS works. So one way to do DNS is to do NS lookup. NS lookup stands for name server lookup. Okay. NS lookup is a command in Windows. I'm sure the same command works in Mac, but I'm not sure. Okay. Somebody can tell me later. But
NSLOOKUP.
So when you say NSLOOKUP www.bushtel.edu, this is what you get. You will get that the name server for bushtel.edu is ns00.ip.bushtel.edu and its address is 128.252.01. Okay. And the bushtel.edu itself is this number. Then you can say google.com and then you get the same thing. And here is another thing, non-authoritative answer. Name google.com, these are all the addresses. So it gives you lots of addresses. Because there are lots of addresses for google.com. And all of them can be reached by www.google.com. And this is non-authoritative. Means this answer is may be correct, may not be correct. I'm not sure, I guess. So this is a non-authoritative answer. Now, I will explain to you what is an authoritative answer in a minute. But before that, the way DNS is done is that there is a root, and each root has children. And each children have children. So the root is called dot. And the immediate children are com, arg, edu. So all the names end with a dot. Before the ending, they will have either com, arg, or edu. Right? Those are called root level domain. And then com has many children. For example, yahoo.com, amazon.com, rajan.com, and so on and so forth. Right? And arg has many children like pbs.org and edu has many children, so on and so forth. And now that I have rajan.com, I can have my own domain children. I can have one computer named computer1.rajan.com, computer2.rajan.com, www.rajan.com, mailserver.rajan.com, you know, whatever I want to name, I have complete freedom to name my children. Makes sense, right? I don't have to go and ask somebody, but Rajan.com, the only person who has freedom to give me the name Rajan is .com, because I'm a child of .com, and if they have already named somebody else, Rajan.com, they cannot give it to me, right? So there cannot be two children with the same name. All right. So everything ends with a dot, but we don't write that dot. The last dot, but everything else we write is. So for example, we already know www.bushtel.edu, right? And so this is dot, edu, and then bushtel, and then www is a child. All right, so these are called root level DNS. Okay, so there are servers for each name. So there is a server which is keeps the whole world's data. Of course, it is under gist, but you know, there is a root server, and then server for DNS, there is server for yahoo.com, there is server for amazon.com, and so on and so forth. So there are root DNS server, there is a top level domain. Now this was the old list. So in the beginning, when they designed, they said there will be three names, com, arg, and edu, and now there are 150 names. So now you can have .me, .gd, .ac, .us, you know, the limit is, there is no limit. Okay. .info, I don't know, I mean, there's a big list now. So this is the top level. And then under that, there are company names. So these are called TLD, top level domain servers. And then authoritative DNS server. So if somebody wants to know really what is the IP address of computer1.rajan.com, the only person who has the correct answer is me, rajan.com, right? So they have to come all the way to rajan.com and ask me what is the address for computer1.rajan.com. So that is an authoritative answer, right? If you ask somebody else, suppose you ask my neighbor, they might have remembered the name because they asked me yesterday, but that is non-authoritative answer. That is a very good answer, but not sure. I might have changed my computer, I might have changed the address. Make sense? So authoritative answer, if you need authoritative answer, you have to go to the source, all the way to the source, which will take some time. But if you don't want to take time, then you just accept that non-authoritative answer. Okay. So how does the DNS work? Basically, there are lots of servers all over the world. And when somebody knows the answer, it gives you the answer. If it doesn't know the answer, it sends it to somebody else. And so there are lots of redirects. Redirects means I don't know the answer, so I ask somebody else. And recursive queries. Recursive queries means that when I say ask somebody, I say please, if you don't know, please ask somebody else. Okay, so that is called recursive. Iterative queries give an answer or a hint. So iterative query is one where you say, all right, well, I give me the answer. If you don't know the answer, then tell me who should I ask. So in this case, they will just tell me, okay, maybe you should go and ask the chair. I will go and ask the chair directly. Right? Recursive means you can ask other people and tell me the answer. And iterative means just tell me what your answer is, and then if not, then tell me who should I ask. And these responses are cached. Every time somebody asks a question, the computer remembers it. So if you ask www.google.com, your computer remembers it. Now, next time when you ask, it is not going to go and ask there. It just knows from its cache. And so here's the thing. Let's see now an example. Let's say you want to find out something about UMass. You want to find out where is the GAIA, gaia.cs.umass.edu. And here you are trying to find out from here. What will happen? If somebody else had asked for that same name, then it will be here already. If nobody had asked before, then it will go to the dns.cs.umass.edu. Right? If you ask for a recursive query, it will go there. If you didn't ask for recursive query, then it will just tell you that, sorry, I don't know, but maybe you can ask dns.ps.umass.edu. That's an iterative query. Now, what this shows is how the flow will happen. So the W, this one will go to .edu, local DNS server. So this is actually local DNS server, Boostel local DNS server. It will go to the root DNS server. Root will say, now you go and find out from this server. That will say, okay, for UMass, you have to go here. So there are lots of messages sent. And finally, when the answer comes back, it is given to this one. All right. I think that's a good point to stop. We will talk about different kinds of DNS records next time.